Welcome to Discovery Watch with John Kaiser.
I'm your host, Jim Goddard. John, one of the big copper-gold discoveries made in the past decade received a friendly buyout offer from Goldcorp this week. Are there any implications for our Discovery Watch juniors?
A big surprise this week was the announcement on March 28th that Goldcorp was buying out Exeter Resources and its Caspiche copper-gold deposit in Chile for stock, 0.12 shares of Goldcorp for each Exeter share, which priced the stock at about $2.58 that day, which was a good premium from where it was sort of motoring along, and it puts about a value of about $250 million on the Caspiche deposit. Now, the Caspiche deposit has about 6 billion pounds of copper in situ and another 24, 25 million ounces of gold. It is, of course, one of those low-grade gold-copper systems that were very popular in the past decade. It was pretty much a grassroots discovery made by Exeter, which had picked up these projects from Anglo-American that they were no longer interested in. But when gold and copper declined, the company ended up in the dumpster, and they went to work on drilling for water during the last few years. Wendell Zerbe became the CEO, and he's put much of his effort into finding water in this water-challenged part of Chile. And he's been successful in it. When the market turned around a year ago, the stock started coming under accumulation as partly an optionality play, but also as a possible sort of consolation prize development play. Because one of the things that Wendell was able to establish was that within this very large system of, 1.6 billion tons of rock, there were higher grade gold cores. And so they developed various development scenarios, including block caving the higher grade gold zones and then doing a sort of a heap leach open pit operation on the enriched gold cap on this. So the smaller scale scenarios. Now what's really interesting is not that far to the north is the Cerro Casale deposit. Very similar in terms of grade and size. And that was identified during the 90s through Bema and Arizona Star. Barrick ended up acquiring 75% of it, and Kinross ended up with 25% for takeover bids that at the time were considerably more generous than these projects turned out to be worth. Now, Cerro Casale has this problem that it has a barren cap on top of it, which means you need to pre-strip the worthless top of the mountain before you get into the copper-gold mineralization. And unlike Caspiche, its mineralization is more evenly distributed. It does not have any sweet spots within it. So the interesting thing about the Goldcorp bid for Exeter is that it was part of a more complicated deal where it purchased Kinross's 25% stake in Cerro Casale for about $300 million. And then agreed to purchase another 25% from Barrick for about $260 million. However, it doesn't really have to pay that in cash to Barrick. What it is, it's donating the Caspiche project that it is acquiring through its Exeter takeover to what will be a 50-50 joint venture between Barrick and Goldcorp that includes both the Cerro Casale and the Caspiche project, and Goldcorp will be running the exploration over the next 6 years, where it will be sort of spending the $250 million or so that it's supposedly paying to Barrick. It's actually going to go in the ground while Barrick gets to sit back. And the beauty of this transaction is that it enables these two projects to pool infrastructure resources. Obviously, Cerro Casale will be the one that gets developed later because it's going to have to be a very large bulk tonnage operation. And Caspiche, because it has these higher grade, smaller scale development potentials, could be the first one. So this is kind of a a win-win development for this region, because both of these deposits were kind of stuck and going nowhere.
So Kinross gets a $300 million cash injection. Exeter's shareholders get a $200 million exit strategy. And these two Chilean copper-gold deposits end up back on the development track. How does this benefit any of our Discovery Watch juniors?
Oh, yes, yes. That was your original question. Well, what's really interesting is that Yale Simpson, who is one of the co-founders of Exeter, happens to be the chairman of one of our Discovery Watch juniors, Adamara Minerals, which has the Cook Mountain Project in northeast Washington. Adamara Minerals is run by Mark Culibaba, who used to run a diamond and a uranium company during the past decade. They were both exploration companies. They ended up bombing out. He ended up merging the two companies together to form Adamara Minerals, and he decided that rather than be in remote locations of the Arctic where it's very expensive, he would go into this old frontier, which has delivered high-grade gold in the past, but has never delivered the sort of tens of millions of ounces of gold that makes it a place that everybody wants to be. So it was kind of an orphaned region. The only party still operating there was Kinross, and there's the connection. Kinross ended up owning the Crown Jewel deposit, which is a high-grade gold skarn. They originally tried to develop it as an open-pit mine, but the Washington regulators would have none of that. They ended up developing it as an underground mine, which turned out to be extraordinarily profitable. They mined the ore. They shipped it to their Buckhorn mill, which they had acquired through Echo Bay, which had developed that for the Lamefoot and Overlook and other deposits in the area. Similar sort of underground high grade gold skarn deposits. But now the Crown Jewel has run out of ore. The Buckhorn Mill will close any month now. It's still processing stockpiled ore, and Kinross has not really done anything in this region. Now, Adamara, it managed to do some work over the past few years, which did not really deliver anything fantastic. And so last year, the management bit the bullet, said, we need a better model. He said, what is the geophysical signatures of all these deposits, these four or five deposits that Echo Bay and Kinross have mined out? They flew a big geophysical survey over the whole area, targeting especially the known deposits. They were quite delighted to discover that not only do these deposits stand out as magnetic anomalies, which is not by itself particularly helpful because lots of other things stand out as magnetic anomalies, but they also saw that there were EM conductors associated with these deposits. And furthermore, in the surrounding area that they also included as part of this geophysical survey, they saw at least five distinct EM mag anomalies that were not associated with any known mines or deposits. And they presented that at the Metals Investor Forum conference last January, which is when I saw it, and I was pretty impressed because they'd finally come up with a new strategy for rethinking this old district. And since then, Mark became extremely paranoid because he realized some of these targets, one of them, the Big Banana, was so big that he sort of said, well, this can't be anything real because such a large target could be an extraordinary discovery if we turn it as such. And he had sent his people out into the field to check because in the case of the Big Banana anomaly, there was known rocks at the surface which were sort of older, probably thrusted rocks which are not known to host anything interesting. And when they ran around in the field with their XRF machine, sort of measuring the mineralization and the rocks that were exposed, and then just looking at the rocks, they realized these rocks here are actually pretty good. There are little windows of the sort of limestone, karsted limestone, brecciated limestone, altered host that are what these skarn deposits sit in, and it's mixed in with all this tedious stuff that you know, nobody would ever want to do. So he's been quite paranoid about Kinross waking up and noticing that that little Atomera is discovering all sorts of unexploited targets right in Kinross's backyard. So they've done more refined work, getting more subtle signatures out of the main deposits. In addition to the initial five, they now have a lot more targets in the region. They've been busy staking what they can and submitting permit applications. And so now you have 200 million bucks ending up into the hands of Exeter shareholders. Where are they going to go with it? Well, Yale Simpson probably has a good idea. Let's take a look at this Atomera. This was this is high grade gold we're looking for. The Torre project that had been spun out from Exeter ended up being taken over and developed as mine. That was a high grade project in Argentina. So it's unnatural to see some of this liquidity that's being created coming into Atomera. And also Kinross, with this $300 million cash that it's getting for a project that was basically going nowhere, it might actually sit up and say, what is going on in our backyard here? We have this mill. We have no ore. What is this junior doing? So I think we're seeing a lot of good things come together that's going to light a fire under our Discovery Watch Junior Atomera Minerals.
Doesn't Atomera have a big warrant overhang created early last year when they had to do a 2.5 cent financing to haul itself out of zombie jail?
Yeah, this is a bit of a problem for Atomera Minerals. They had negative working capital. Management had been accruing its salaries over the past few years as it worked in the Northeast Washington. They had some environmental reclamation obligations to take care of in the Arctic. And right sort of in the first quarter of last year, when the market started to turn, some investors said, let's bite the bullet. Let's get this thing turned around. They did about 15 million units at 2.5 cents, with the big sort of a greedy 5-year, 5-cent warrants in there. And then as the company started getting traction, they did a number of additional financings, a bit higher price and so on. And interestingly, these have started to be exercised. The overhang was such that even Gwen Preston, the resource maven who has backed the company, threw up her hands in despair in late February when Mark Kalibaba said, I don't want to do a financing. I don't want further dilution. We already have 120 million fully diluted. I want to get those warrants exercised. And the stock was selling off early last month early this month when all of a sudden buying started to come in and the stock got back up over 10 cents, sort of 13, 14 cents has chewed through, you know, millions of shares. And on a whole bunch of warrants, that 12 cents that came due a week or so ago, a good chunk of them got exercised. There's another big chunk that comes due at the end of June at 10 cents. And they have a big 12 million share chunk that comes due in December. However, it has an acceleration clause so that if the stock manages to trade above 20 cents for 10 days in a row, then all of a sudden the warrant holders have 30 days to exercise. So there's about 20 million warrants that could end up being cleaned up in the next couple months simply through expiry and through acceleration if the market does catch on to this story. So this warrant overhang has been a problem, but the fundamental work that management has been doing is increasing the market's appetite for this story. And this Exeter development is an extra bonus that could steer additional capital into sector and chew through these warrants. They've already got $1 million working capital. They would get another million and a half if they get them exercised. And so they would be able to go on a serious drill program, which should be underway by June, to test these new targets. And if they start delivering high-grade intervals from any one of these targets, the glass goes very, very much half full on this story.
Discovery Watch with John Kaiser. We'll be right back after the break.
Avon Resources Limited is a gold exploration company. with significant projects in British Columbia, Saskatchewan, and the Yukon. Trading on the TSX Venture Exchange, symbol ABN, and the pink symbol ABNAF. Surrounded by world-class gold deposits and mines, Avon's 23,000 hectares Forest Kerr Gold Project is located in the heart of the Golden Triangle in northwestern BC. For more information, visit us at avonresources.com.
I'm Larry Ray, President and CEO of American Manganese, Inc., listed on the TSX Venture, ticker symbol AMY, A-M-Y, with proprietary patents in the U.S., China, and South Africa. Our focus is on recycling lithium-ion batteries for electric vehicles. China recently legislated the responsibility for recycling onto their electric vehicle manufacturers and importers. For more information, please visit AmericanManganeseInc.com or phone me, Larry Ray, at 778-574-4444.
Welcome back to Discovery Watch with John Kaiser. Arizona Mining Inc. has seen its stock price weaken during March. Has there been any bad news?
Well, metal prices have stopped rising. They have sort of stalled. The so-called Trump infrastructure rally now seems to have had its limit. Helped along, of course, by last week's Obamacare debacle, where they ended up failing to repeal and replace Obamacare because the hardcore austerity Tea Party types in the party said, no, unless you really, really make it nasty for all these other people who benefited from Obamacare, we will not support you. And of course, the infrastructure spending that Trump wants to do will require, is a form of fiscal stimulus, which will increase the deficit. And so it's now clear that this minority of the Republican Party will not support anything that will increase the deficit. And so that's kind of taking the steam out of the Trump rally. Now, the company did put out a news release this week, a metallurgical study. And of course, metallurgy has become a big issue with the Hermosa-Taylor project because it's come out that there's about a 1-2% manganese content in the concentrate, which is a deleterious element that attracts a penalty from the smelters. If it's too high, they won't even accept it. In the case of the Hermosa-Taylor project, the manganese content is low enough that the concentrate could be blended with other concentrates, perhaps ones with too much arsenic or mercury, which the Hermosa-Taylor zinc concentrate is blessed with not having very much of at all. So this latest metallurgical study conceded, yes, there will be a penalty, did not quantify it, mentioned that the recoveries for the ore are better than what was originally assumed. But what's really making the stock weaken is the company has said next week, the week of April the 3rd, we will publish a preliminary economic assessment. And this is a very important document because people like myself and mining analysts have done our own speculative models of what this mine would look like, what it would cost. But all the nitty-gritty details that the company controls, we can only guess at those. So next week we're going to see a very important news release which tells us a lot about the economics of this project. And I suspect the market is deciding to err on the side of caution and assuming that the less rosy numbers will come out than people like myself have suggested.
We'll wrap up Discovery Watch with John Kaiser right after this.
I'm Bill McWilliam, president of Cascadero Copper, CCD on the TSX Venture Exchange. Cesium is one of the world's rarest metals with a growing industrial demand. Drilling is underway on our Tehran property in Argentina to prove up a cesium resource. Cascadero's patent-pending leach process has the potential to make Cascadero the lowest-cost supplier of cesium in the world. Visit our website, cascadero.com, or phone us at 604-924-5504.
Gem International is a new diamond explorer in the richest diamond-producing country in Africa, located next to the fourth largest producing diamond mine in the world. International Spotlight is on an 1,109-carat diamond recently discovered in Africa by a fellow Canadian junior with a proven operator and finance team. Gem International trades on the TSX Venture Exchange. Symbol GI. Visit us at gemdiamondmining.com.
Welcome back. John, are there any new Discovery Watch plays on your horizon?
During the past week, I have done a lot of homework on something that is actually a blast from the past. It's a company called SK Mining Corp, which owns the SIB Lulu project south of the SK Creek mine, which ceased production in 2005. When I was an analyst with Pacific International back in the late 80s, you know, we had a pretty bad bear market, but one of the big things that entertained us was Murray Pesum's discovery of the SK Creek deposit, where he pulled, with a 1,000-meter step out, pulled hole 109, which ended up turning into a regional area play. It helped give us the name Golden Triangle for this part of northwestern British Columbia, and it created a takeover battle between Placer Dome and Corona for control of Calpine and Stikine. It was a very exciting period. The SK Creek mine had phenomenal grades. It was a volcanogenic massive sulfide deposit that has zinc and copper credits, but it had been enriched with gold and silver. By the time it was done, it had produced 3.5 million ounces of gold and 180 million ounces of silver. And the ore grade was 43 grams per ton gold and over 2,000 grams per ton silver. This, at today's prices, this is like $3,000 to $4,000 per ton rock. And only 2.5 million tons at the end of the day were identified and mined. And so the dream always was, are there other such VMS, gold and silver enriched, within this system? And at the time, one of the companies that I followed as a bottom fish was Silver Butte Resources. It owned a group of claims to the south of the old Tom Mackay claims that consolidated Stikine, had optioned to Calpine, which ended up hosting the SK Creek deposit. And these claims, of course, were owned from way back in the 1920s for good reasons, because there was a lot of alteration in the rocks. There was gold smoke all over the place. And so Silver Butte ended up teaming up with another junior called American Fiber Corp, which was controlled by Lou Dillman, who was a legend in that period. His stock promotions did extremely well. He was into the Canadian junior scene. They did a 50-50 joint venture on the property on strike with the SK Creek discovery. And in their first year, or the second year of drilling, they intersected a fantastic zone, 16 meters of, half ounce gold and, 1 ounce silver, the same sort of host rock as SK Creek. And we had a big exploration play going there. And unfortunately, as they drilled around it, and they ended up naming it the Lulu Zone after Lou Stark from Silver Butte and Lou Dillman from American Fiber, they could never find more of it. And the play fizzled. Homestake, which ended up owning and operating the SK Creek mine, it drilled extensively along strike close to the border. Never did find anything very much. The property ended up being owned by another company, St. Andrews, Andrew Goldfields. It had some Australians come in there, and they did a lot of modeling and came up with new ideas of what's going on. Did some drilling, but never did the right type of drilling to test this theory. And what has changed in the last quarter is that Silver Standard has done a tentative deal with SK Mining to option up to 60% of the project in exchange for about $12 million worth of exploration over the next 3 years. And the driving force behind this is Carl Edmonds, their exploration VP, who worked on the for Homestake on the project and is quite familiar with what these rocks look like. And what they're looking for, literally, is another SK Creek zone. And what they what the approach they're taking now is they're saying there is a thrust fault in this area called the Coulter Creek thrust, which has moved the rock package somewhat to the west, not a huge distance, maybe up to 1,000 meters or so, but the Lulu Zone has been pretty much decapitated from its source. And so when you drill through it, you end up getting nothing underneath it, and attempts to drill east of that to find where the original part of it is, that's been the wrong angle. So now we have part of this sort of new exploration phenomenon in this system where Silver Standard's going to go in there and step to the west of the Coulter Creek thrust fault limit and drill 1,000-meter-plus angle holes into the footwall to intersect the stratigraphy that should host the Eskay Creek 2 deposit, because the stratigraphy itself has been tilted on its side. These deposits typically form in a submarine type of setting, and of course what's happened in this part of the world is everything's been jumbled around by faulting and so on. So the stratigraphy is on its side. They're now drilling it from an angle in order to map this stratigraphy beneath the detachment fault. And if they should start getting the sort of smoke that is indicative of the Eskay Creek system, we know that the Lulu Zone comes from something very good. We could have a major new discovery play in this part of the world.
If Silver Standard is successful, what would that mean for the 20% net interest Eskay Mining ends up with at the end of the day?
Well, one of the things that's changed in the last 20 years or so is that companies have a lot more shares fully diluted. Back when Stikine had 50% of the Eskay Creek discovery, it ended up going from like 40 cents to $60 because it had all of 5 million shares outstanding. Now, the way you price a project is you multiply the fully diluted by the stock price and then divide by the net interest. Now, in the case of Eskay Creek Mining, they will net 20% at the end of the day. So 120 million shares fully diluted times 20 cents, that gives it a market cap of about just under 30 million. But then when you divide by the 0.2, the 20% interest to get, like, how's the market pricing the project on a 100% basis, you get a value of $160 million. So if another Eskay Creek were to be found, that would probably be worth at least $2 billion in net present value terms, and you could see the stock going maybe from like say 160 million to up 10 times in price. So you get maybe a $3 stock price. So you don't get the spectacular type of gains anymore because of the larger number of shares outstanding. Now, in terms of implications, that would be pretty substantial for all the shareholders. However, the company has sold only or optioned only a portion of the SIB claims to Silver Standard. So it still has 80% of the immediate surrounding ground. But more importantly, it also has 100% of a much bigger chunk of land to the south, which covers that same sort of a formation of Eskay Creek type rocks, where over $20 million has been spent since the 90s by operators of this company. It's been a haphazard type of exploration program with the new modeling of what makes this area tick, what makes these Eskay Creek systems tick. I would suspect that if Eskay Mining started getting joy at the SIB Lulu target, there would be tremendous interest in exploring the rest of this belt, which it owns 100%. And in that case, you know, you're back to just 120 million shares times 30 cents, which is a $30-40 million valuation. Well, if they found Eskay Creek 3 on their property, that also ends up being worth $2 billion. Well, 30 times 3 times 10, you would see a 30-time price increase. So you would see sort of a $10 to $20 type of reward emerge from that. So going forward, you're going to see the market at first sort of be skeptical that SK Creek 2 will materialize through Silver Standard's efforts, but when we start seeing that it's starting to be a case that, yeah, it's just a matter of time before they find it, then interest will go into the company's 100%, 80% and 100% owned ground, and you get sort of a bifurcated valuation approach to the company that could turn this into a very, very exciting discovery play that reminds of back in the 1989 to 91, when everything ended up fizzling, the Golden Triangle faded away, the NDP came in and ruined the exploration in British Columbia, and everybody wandered off to South America and other third world frontiers, only recently has the Golden Triangle come back to life. So Discovery Watch, for our Discovery Watch program, SK Mining Corp is one of my first companies that I'm focusing on, and there's going to be a lot more that I'm going to be paying attention to later this year in this northwestern part of British Columbia.
John, thanks for the update.
Thank you, Jim.
We've been speaking with John Kaiser, his website, kaiserresearch.com. Discovery Watch will be back next week. I'm Jim Goddard.
Comments made on Discovery Watch are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any manner whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Archived online at howstreet.com. Discovery Watch is a production of How Street Media Incorporated.